All right, and good evening. Welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. You can find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Chris DiGiorgio, California Managing Director at Accenture, Bay Area, also on the Bay Area Council Executive Committee and co-chair of the Joint Venture Silicon Valley Network. Today we'll be talking about the state of California's higher public education. This year we celebrate the 50th year of the innovative California Master Plan for Higher Education. This plan was to guide the state in successfully creating a public higher education system that was the envy of the world. The plan looked to increase our overall efficiency in higher education system and to produce greater numbers of graduates by promising a certain percentage of state high school student admittance to Cal State and UC systems and the promise that community colleges would accept all applications. As we celebrate the 50th year of the master plan, California's public higher education system faces unprecedented challenges. The state's growing population creates demands on the public higher education system at the same time the state budget allocations are shrinking. Our state legislators and higher education leaders are wrestling with the system's methods of governance, its financing, and particularly the inclusiveness of the system in a stringent budget and climate. The outcomes of this rethinking process now underway about our higher education system will shape whether California's future workforce is globally competitive. It will also determine whether we have the broadly educated population with the ability to participate in a democratic process, adapt to the needs of our rapidly changing social, economic, and political environments. And now to get on with the program and get started, I'd like to introduce our panelists. I'll turn it over to tonight's moderator and the president and CEO of the Commonwealth Club, Dr. Gloria Duffy.
Thank you, Chris. And a big thanks to Accenture, Chris's company, which takes a strong interest in higher education, for underwriting tonight's event. Welcome, everyone, to our discussion of the status of public higher education in our great state of California. Tonight, we have the best authorities we could possibly have to discuss the topic at hand, the chiefs of all three California public higher education systems. So please welcome our panelists. To my far right, President Mark Yudof of the University of California, then Chancellor Jack Scott of the Community College System, and Chancellor Charles Reed of the California State University System. I've asked each panelist to spend about 5 minutes initially describing the major challenges his system, his part of the system, is facing. Then we'll move on to discussion and to audience questions. So let me introduce our panelists. President Yudof, a law professor, has been president of UC since 2008. Previously, he served as chancellor of the University of Texas system and president of the University of Minnesota. He was the law school dean at the University of Texas at Austin, and he's an expert on constitutional law, freedom of expression, and education law. His BA and law degrees are from the University of Pennsylvania. To my immediate left, Dr. Charles Reed was appointed chancellor of the California State University System in 1998. He holds his doctorate in teacher education, his MS in secondary education, and his BS in health and physical education, all from the George Washington University. Chancellor Reed was previously chancellor of the Florida State University System and chief of staff for the governor of Florida. He is an expert on education, finance, management, governance, and the politics of education. And in the center, California State Senator Jack Scott became the 14th chancellor of the California Community Colleges in early 2009. He holds a BA from Abilene Christian University, a Master of Divinity from Yale University, and a PhD in American History from Claremont Graduate University. He served as president of Cypress College and Pasadena City College. He served in the California State Legislature from 1996 to 2008, where he chaired the Senate Budget and Fiscal Review Subcommittee on Education. Please welcome Chancellor Reed, Chancellor Scott, and President Yudof. And now I'll ask each of you to briefly describe the challenges you and your system is facing, starting with President Yudof.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Duffy. And it's hard for a law professor to do anything in 5 minutes, but let me go through this briefly. I'm an insider for 2 years and an outsider for much longer. I'm a big advocate of the master plan. I think it was a great idea. I think it's still the envy of the nation. And the features of it that I think are most important are, first, it tiered the systems. So unlike many states, you do not waste billions of dollars trying to create a medical school or a graduate school of engineering in every county in the state, and there are places around the country where that happened. It created an integrated system with access across the board and a sort of orderly plan as to how the state would deal with that. It provided for research universities. So I think the plan is very good. It's being examined in the legislature, but it's fundamentally sound in my view. The problem is a lack of funding, and I'll tell you what our challenges are. We have half as much to spend per student as we did in 1990 in adjusted dollars, taking account of enrollment growth and inflation over that period. And our fees, recently redesignated as tuition, at least by our commission on the future, have risen geometrically over that period. We've increased financial aid, but we have a challenge in terms of what we charge. We have a challenge keeping our core education mission of graduate students, undergraduates, the sort of humanities, social sciences, particularly the areas that do not have large research subsidies. And one way to think about the university, to give you some insight, is 10 campuses, 3 national labs, 5 medical centers, $20 billion budget, $2.5 billion comes from the state of California. And that doesn't demean or denigrate that number, because that's our core mission, to educate people, young people in California. But that's where we're suffering the most. If you think about what we do, take University of California, San Francisco, not far from here. It has a $3.3 billion budget, and about $200 million comes from the state of California. So we have a research mission, which is vibrant. We're doing $5 billion worth of research a year. We have a patient care mission, which is vibrant, and serving 3.8 million patient visits in a year. But the core of the university, providing a quality experience for our students, is most in jeopardy due to these budget reductions. So that really is our core challenge. And I would add, I know it's a difficult time for our legislature. And all three leaders, the Speaker, the President Pro Tem of the Senate, and the Governor, have very supportive budgets to restore a portion of our reductions. The reductions were about 20% in a 14-month period. But there are some details they don't agree on. Like, you know, some would borrow, some would raise taxes, and some would do substantial cuts in other services. And this is what I wanted to say. I understand when dental care for indigent people is at issue, or health care for children, and many other things that are critically important to people in their daily lives. But a state like California will not move ahead if it does not set aside what they used to say in Texas was their seed corn. And that is, if it's all in consumption and you're not planning for the future, because we are not going to survive in this state on low taxes. We are not going to survive on low regulation. We're not going to survive on low wages. We have made other, I think, pretty good choices along the way. That means we have to do things smarter. We have to be creative. And the most creative and the most technology transfer we do in a year is when we graduate 40,000 students. And we have to continue that. Otherwise, the pie will not grow. And in that sense, all these social programs, which are so compelling, will not continue at any high level because there will simply be a much smaller pie to divide over time. So those are our main issues, Gloria.
Thank you, President Yudof. Chancellor Scott, your main challenges.
Well, we are one of those places that has tremendous demand and yet insufficient supply. And the insufficient supply that we have stems from the fact that the resources aren't granted to us as a result of the scarcity of dollars in the state budget. Let me tell you a little bit about California community colleges. And of course, I'm very proud of them. I was fortunate to serve two different community colleges as president prior to going to the legislature. It is the most egalitarian, democratic element in public higher education in California. Last year, we enrolled 2.89 million students. the largest system of higher education in the entire U.S. and some say in the entire world. We're proud of that. But suddenly we can't meet the demand because of the fact we experienced, for instance, an 8% cut in our resources this year alone. And so we had to begin to cut back course sections. I'm sure those of you here in San Francisco may have noticed that in the City College of San Francisco. And so as a result of that, we cut our course sections by about 6%. Now, our enrollment didn't go down but 0.2% because we just filled the classes to capacity much sooner and almost to complete capacity. And so that's the situation that we're confronted with. What do the community colleges do? Well, the community colleges, first, we simply accept the top 100% who graduate from high school. So we're open enrollment, and we're proud of that fact, that here people get a second chance. Here, many first-generation students. We have many students of color. In fact, we almost mirror the population of the state of California. We have a few higher percentage of students of color, actually, than the population of California. So here we are taking all comers, transfer education. Yes, we do that as well the first 2 years, and certainly as CSU and UC has been forced to turn away more students, we're the place where many of the students come. We also furnish 2 years of career technical education. We have 175 different programs in everything from nursing to becoming an electrician to someone who wants to be a machinist or an auto technician or a computer specialist. All of those things we do and do very well. And we're very proud of that. In fact, there's a study recently that said in California between 2008 and 2018 that the growth in those mid-level jobs, those career technical jobs that people come with, is going to grow by 19%. And so we find that when people come out with a certificate in one of our career technical programs, that they are within a very short period of time, they're within 3 years, their income increases by 65%. So our biggest challenge, it's obviously a lack of resources. And I'm very much like what President Yudof has just said. We're making a serious mistake in California if we don't provide education. This year, we had to turn away probably as many as 140,000 students that couldn't find one class. So we do have that situation that's confronting us, and we simply say we're doing the job. We'll talk a little bit about ways in which we're working on efficiency and things of that nature as the program progresses. But if you say, what is our challenge? Our challenge is to serve the needs of those students who are knocking on our doors.
Thank you, Chancellor Scott. And Chancellor Reed, the state university's challenges.
Thank you, Dr. Duffy. First, for those of you that came this evening, thank you. And thank you for your interest in higher education. The California State University is a university system of 23 campuses from Humboldt in the north to San Diego in the south. This year we served about 450,000 students. 57% of our students are students of color. Many or most of those students come from the underserved communities of California. Our operating budget is about $6 billion, about $4 billion from tuition, if you can use that word tonight, instead of fees, and from the state, and about $2 billion that we earn for ourselves. I would like to say what Mark said about the master plan. The master plan in California is a brilliant, forward-looking plan, even though it's 50 years old. There's almost no month that goes by that somebody from Europe, from Asia, India, that don't come by our office to learn about the master plan, that they would like to copy the master plan back in their country. So 50 years later, I think that the master plan is still gives us a good framework for meeting California's future needs. As both of my cohorts said, though, In order to make the master plan work, you have to fund it. And that's what California has backed off of for the past few years. Like the University of California, the California State University took a cut of $625 million this last year, 20% of our operating budget. Now, that master plan assigns to the California State University the responsibility to prepare California's workforce. And if you think of the workforce in two groups, the economic side, our friend Chris, who go into the business side, engineering, agriculture, hotel, restaurant management, movie, motion picture, we prepare slightly more than 50% of all of California's workforce that enters that economic area. On the other hand, the people who serve the people of California, nurses, welfare workers, criminal justice system, the state employees, we prepare anywhere from 70 to almost 90% of that workforce. Now, this past month, I have attended several commencements and graduations, and I really like that. This year, I can say to you that we graduated in the California State University more than 92,000 students who will enter California's workforce. However, the Public Policy Institute of Florida just recently came out with a study which said that by 2025, California is going to be short 1 million workers without a baccalaureate degree. And to be competitive on a worldwide basis, California needs those educated workers. So we have our challenge cut out for ourselves. Now, the California State University takes and admits the top one-third of the high school graduates who have a B average. However, many of our students in that K through 12 pipeline need extra assistance in mathematics and in English and writing. 40% of our students come from families where English is the second language spoken. 80% of our students work, some part-time, some full-time. Many of our students have families. More than half of our students are Latino students. And we see that pipeline from K through 12 growing. Today, it's about 68% of the students in K through 12 in California are Latino students. So our focus is to reach out to the K through 12 schools and to do everything that we can to get students better prepared to go to college, so that when they get to us, they can do college level work. Earlier today, I hosted a luncheon for about 60 African-American ministers in Oakland. We have a program called Super Sundays, and this year we went to 102 African-American churches. This is 5 years in a row that we have done that, and we have seen our African-American enrollment increase. We have a program to reach out to Latinos, to Asians, and especially Koreans, Vietnamese, Hmong, and to Native Americans. Now, that is our challenge, is to figure out how we can serve that underserved community. That's what California's population looks like today. That population needs extra help and extra assistance, not just in the remedial areas, but to learn about what it takes to go to college, when and how to apply, how to receive financial aid, and how to continue their financial aid once they're a part of the California State University. My colleague and I, and later I think this will come up, we were asked about what are we doing to save money, to save resources. Jack Scott and I are working with the California legislature to increase the transfer, because California State University, two-thirds of our students come from the community colleges. And if we can smooth out that transfer process, we have estimated that we're going to save $100 million. And when I say that, that's going to provide $100 million of seats, of access, of admission for California students. And so that's our biggest challenge, is to figure out how to educate more students and to do it successfully so that they graduate with less money. I want to just end with this. I believe that in the last 10 or 15 years, and you know, I have only been here in California 12 or 13 years, but in America, I think we've lost sight about our priorities. And I came from Florida. The same thing happened there. Jack came from Texas. Mark did. Where our public policymakers got on this kick that we need to lock everybody up forever. And we got into this three strikes and you're out. We got into this minimum mandatory sentencing. We got, you know, to where now the California prison system gets more money than the University of California, the California State University, and most of the community colleges together. That is outrageous that California is spending their money on failures and not investing in its future. And some of those policies have to change going forward.
Thank you, Chancellor Reed, and all of you gentlemen. We've referred to the California Master Plan for Higher Education, which was a far-seeing plan adopted by the California State Legislature in 1960 under the guidance of a state senator by the name of Dorothy Donahoe. And there is a website that UC Berkeley has put up, which has a historical discussion and description of the master plan. Part of our discussion tonight touches back to that 50-year anniversary of the master plan, which set up the three-tiered system and how they would be funded, and the UC, the Board of Trustees, Board of Regents, and so on. So if you're interested, I do have the website information on that UC Berkeley website that explains in detail what that is, and you can look for yourself to see how it relates to the current situation. So I'm going to go to some of my questions and some of the audience questions, and because you raised it, Dr. Reed, could you say a little bit more about how you're collaborating? You're collaborating among the three systems on the issue of transfers and smoothing the path for transferring students. Are there other areas? All of the challenges you described were fairly similar in terms of the budget situation and so on. So there must be other areas in which you are collaborating to address those challenges.
Well, in the 12 years that I've been Chancellor of the California State University, the communications, the collaboration, the partnership, and the working together has never been better than it has been these last 18 months or so between the University of California, CSU, and the community colleges. As I said, we're trying to smooth out the transfer process. We're also looking at how we can help each other with our IT and the cost, our administrative cost. We're sharing with the University of California a large travel proposal where with the size of the two systems, we can get discounts. We're currently working with the University of California on purchasing discounts and saving money that way. We're looking at trying to figure out how to reduce the cost of textbooks. We're looking at electronically how we have faculty share those kinds of information together.
That's one of the things we've been doing too as far as electronic textbooks. Let me just quickly indicate what this transfer agreement is going to be. Now, one of the things that shortly after President Yudof arrived in California, he called me up and he said, let's work on a transfer task force, and we're working on that. The actual bill that we're talking about would simply say that when a student finishes, gets a transfer, we'll have a transfer associate degree from a community college of 30 units. and that will have 39 units of general education.
60 units.
I know. What did I say?
30.
Okay, I'm sorry. 60
You'll
units.
Scare my faculty to death.
I know. I'm glad you corrected me, Charlie. You're exactly right. It's 60 units. 39 units will be general education that will transfer. 18 units of an area of emphasis, and CSU will promise that they will take this, and we'll have immediate junior standing, and that they will require no more than an additional 60 units to graduate. Now, you may say, well, what's so good about that? Well, unfortunately, right now, we're averaging about 160 units for a community college transfer, which goes to CSU and graduates. So you can see the savings that he's talking about. But I thought you might like to see that fleshed out.
I just had two brief things. We're also doing advocacy together. Mm-hmm. And we've worked closely together, and I think we're having some effect. So we go to the Capitol and walk the halls and appear together in various forums, and we really are an integrated system. I mean, this is just true. If you reduce the budget of the community colleges, you hurt the University of California, and you hurt the California State Universities, and that could be said for each of these institutions. And the other thing I wanted to say is I am extremely sympathetic, and we just sent a letter in endorsing in concept one of these bills. I think transfer students are part of the solution for all the reasons that they've talked about, but also because we would get more students through the system from our standpoint, more students getting their bachelor's degrees and their PhDs and their medical degrees and whatever they want to be and can be in life. And it's a more diverse group. I mean, and it cuts down on the cost to the state. It cuts down on the cost to the family. So. I'm very enthusiastic. I mean, I won't say there are no obstacles to overcome, but it's a very good idea.
Chancellor Scott, you were talking about the budgetary cutbacks and the demand for classes and the inability to meet the demand for classes. And I understand your campuses are now running 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. to try to meet the demand. What about the use of technology? It sounds like a solution to this might be more online or other distance learning type of measures to try to satisfy, keep those students engaged and keep them moving along and enrolled to some degree, even if not physically present on campus.
Well, certainly I think distance education is one of the solutions. Right now, about 5.5% of our classes are online, and 17% of our students take an online course. So we've tried to lead the way in that. We've had some real colleges like Coastline College down in Orange County that created a lot of online education. But I think that's something that we ought to look at in the future. And I think we'll need more and more hybrid classes that are, you know, the classes in which a portion of it would be online and a portion of it would be the lecture in the classroom. So we're moving in that direction. Higher education has not always been the most innovative place in terms of making changes, but I think all of us would join in and say, the three of us here on the platform, that we're looking for results. And, you know, if someone, by taking an online course, performs just as well as they do if they happen to have been in a classroom, then that can happen. I mean, we've got things like chat rooms that are now working, and counseling can occur actually online. So there's a lot of opportunities out there.
Other comments on this use of technology, online learning?
At the University of California, we have a proposal that would create 25 to 40 courses online in the general education program done by our own faculty. And sort of an internal RFP process, and we try to get the best of our faculty to do it. I think there's some resistance, but if you look at the history, Jack put it just right there. We're not always known for our technological innovation, and I'm sure there was some professor at the Sorbonne who decried the printing press. And it will occur. I mean, the question is when. And it has certain efficiencies, and if we do a course, we can make it available to the community colleges. Cal State does extensive work here. There's no reason why some of those courses couldn't be cross-listed. I think we'll get there, but I'd like to be a first mover. And at the moment, I'm pushing it. I don't really feel the university is the first mover. And we have to work out the quality control. That's a big issue. I mean, anyone can, any damn fool can go online and say it's a course, but how are we going to police it for the quality of the offering and what gets credit and what doesn't get credit? But I think we'll work it out eventually, but I'd like eventually to be sooner rather than later.
Well, of course, technology can help us reach more students. It can save us from having to build new facilities. You know, if a student comes to class twice a week instead of three times, but the other time is they're online, that'll make us more efficient, and we're working to do that. About 10% of our courses are online courses. But, you know, what we have found is the students are way ahead of the rest of us in their social networking and through them sharing with each other study groups and things like that, and we found that to be very valuable. But also, I want to see technology help us be much smarter. You know, for instance, when I was in Florida, we had technology that traced students from pre-kindergarten through the university system. And the technology sent all of the transcripts, all of the classes from a community college to a four-year institution, from a high school to a community college. And in California, we've been afraid to do that. And the loser are the students who have to work, you know, the paper, mail something. I mean, that's nuts in an age that we're in now. So we're trying to make technology help us be smarter.
Thank you. Chancellor Reed, you were quite eloquent on the misplaced priorities between funding the failures in the prison system versus the future successes from the higher education system. And there are a couple questions from the audience that relate to this, but also are questions about politics. Can you explain why Californians spend more money on prisons than on education? And then the 1960 Master Plan needed the leadership of Governor Pat Brown to make it a success. What can we expect from a Governor Whitman or Jerry Brown? What is their plan for supporting, I guess, higher education?
I'm sure that they would both say that they support higher education. They're both very well educated and have a respect. But I can honestly say I don't know right now, you know, what their higher education plans are. If I drop back, why does it cost, why are prisons funded more than education? Well, it costs $60,000 per prisoner. And if you have upwards of 200,000 prisoners at $60,000 per year to keep them in prison, that's why it costs more. The California State University receives $8,000 per year to educate a student. That's why that budget is as big as it is. Now, another reason, you come back to those new or different or put them in and lock them up and forget them forever policies. I see a few folks here with gray hair and kind of getting up into the fourth quarter of the age group. The same thing has happened in our prison system. And the health care cost of prisoners over the age of 70 is astronomical. It costs almost $100,000 a year for a prisoner over the age of 70. And if you want a liver transplant, the federal government, the judges have said you have to provide that kind of health care to the prisoners, or a heart transplant or whatever. So that is what is breaking part of California's bank.
You know, I was in the legislature for 12 years, and I can tell you the root of this problem. One thing is that the public and the legislature is too often focusing on cures rather than prevention. We believe education is one of the great prevention projects that would have a lot to do with the lessening of incarceration and welfare and other social costs. But, you know, we just caught a slogan like three strikes and you're out, and we didn't stop and think about the fact that that might be, you know, $1 million if you put a person away for life very easily. So, and then some legislators are fearful, well, if I vote that way, it will be, I'll be viewed as soft on crime. I remember a bill that was introduced to study the three strikes plan, which I incidentally supported, and we couldn't get it out of the legislature because of that fear. So we've got to look once again at this idea of how much it is costing us in terms of the correction systems in California. And really, when you stop and think about sending somebody away for life who happens to be involved in some kind of drug offense, really doesn't make that much sense. We ought to be involved in more rehabilitation and a lot less in foolishly just sending somebody away for life. We all know that we need to warehouse some dangerous, violent criminals. None of us are against that. But we've got to restudy this matter because it's crowding out the rest of our budget. It's one of those things, and I could go on and tell you what some of the forces are behind that, but I gave you a little clue.
President Yudof, thoughts on that question?
Well, I'm new to California, and I don't pretend to understand its politics.
I'm fourth generation,
I didn't pretend to understand either. Two-thirds requirement, and I taught constitutional law, but no constitution that looked like the California Constitution. There's a lot of sympathy for higher education, but it doesn't seem to translate into hard dollars. It may be there's a court order for the prisons. It may be the attitudes toward crime and the three strikes. Matching funds from Washington on health care costs. I mean, there are a bunch of structural things, and we need a short course in delaying gratification. I mean, you really do need to invest. I mean, the infrastructure, you need highways, you need levees, you need the human infrastructure for it to be successful. And too often, I think we've taken the shortcut. I think it's just not smart, but it really takes some statesmanship. I also think we could use some leadership from Washington. We've never had an integrated sort of holistic higher education plan in America. You know, we have GI bills, we had the Morrill Act, which was groundbreaking, the best $7 million we ever spent to create really the research apparatus of the country. But one of the things I wanted to say, and I really support the president's plan, but we will never meet his objectives if we continue along the path that we're continuing. You cannot increase Pell Grants, and you cannot do a better job of outreach, and you cannot help the students of color to get into the universities, and that's what we all want, unless you increase the capacity. If Jack cuts out 140,000 students, it almost doesn't matter what the Pell Grants are going to be. And I think they understand that in Washington, but there's a long line. There's health care, and there's energy policy, and there's reform of financial markets, and so forth. You have to have a plan, and every business person knows this. There's supply and demand. And everything we're doing is to boost the demand, but there's nothing to boost the supply, and that just will not work. And the national figures, of course, are like California. I can't remember, but it's 15 or 20 million new degrees would be needed within a 15-year period.
Just on the question of prisons, an interesting question. Prisons have educational classes and opportunities. Do any of your systems work with California prisons to get people back in school or provide them with degrees after they are released from prison?
There are fewer and fewer education programs, and they have really cut way back on that. But through distance education, through the web, we have served people through correspondence courses. We have served people in prisons. As a matter of fact, I just got a letter the other day from someone who was getting out of prison and said that they had gotten their bachelor's and their master's degree from California State University, wanted to know if they could continue their education on one of our campuses. But there's not enough of that goes on.
I introduced a bill, for instance, we can do it through distance education. But the archaic rule that says, our classes have to be open to the public, obviously if you hold a class in prison, not many of the public is going to want to break in and take that class. So I introduced a bill, and the Department of Finance was under the illusion that in some way or another that would increase the expenses. Well, we have a cap on every community college, so that wouldn't have increased the expenses. But for some reason, I wasn't able to convince the Department of Finance, and as a result, that bill got vetoed. But if we could go into prisons with our vocational education and our career technical education, we could have people coming out of prisons with some kind of skill that they in turn could use. I can guarantee you that if somebody comes out and they don't have any skills and they can't get a job, it's going to be very inviting for that person to return to crime. And we have the highest recidivism rate of any state in the nation. So we've got a problem here.
So the private colleges and universities have had active fundraising and successful fundraising in the private from private finance for many years because the three state systems were funded largely from the state budget. They've not perhaps had as developed fundraising focused on private philanthropy and so on. I just heard the other day that USC has announced a new $5 billion endowment campaign and is going to increase their development staff from 350 to 450. So what are the three, to what extent can private fundraising, private philanthropy fill this gap? What steps are all of you taking or have you been taking in recent years to ramp up your fundraising capacity from alumni and from private donors? And again, is this part of the solution for you?
I think it's part. And we have ramped it up. And we collectively collect over $1 billion. UCLA and Berkeley in particular do well. A new institution like Merced doesn't have the alumni support to do it. But I have to say something about it. 92% of the gifts we get are restricted. So someone says, I made my fortune in electrical engineering, I want an electrical engineering chair. Or I'm very concerned about breast cancer, or I'm very concerned about nanotechnology, and it goes on and on. So it is extremely helpful, but to me it's more of a source of excellence. It doesn't pay the bills. We were reduced $800 million. If we wanted an endowment to replace it, I'm not good at this, but it's at least $15 billion. $15 billion, which is more than the current endowment for the University of California, just to replace those dollars. I mean, it's a public good. And I think, in general, the supporters and donors, they have particular ends in mind, and they're not interested in copying machines and pointing the bricks and so forth. They want to see programs, and they want to see progress in areas that they think are important. So it's a partial solution, and we wrapped it up, but realistically, it's no substitute for adequate state funding.
Private funding allows universities to do things that they can't do based on their state funding. But when you're a state institution, yes, people give us money and they've been very generous, but there is an expectation that the state is supposed to fund access for our students. And it's not the private sector that needs to fund public universities. So we don't want to get that mixed up or confused. In the California State University, I've set a goal for our smaller institutions to raise 10% from the private sector of their budget, mid-sized institutions 15%, and our large institutions 20%. But as Mark said, most of the people who give us those gifts want to earmark them for scholarships, endowments, some want to see their name on a building. So they are targeted gifts, and they're not gifts where we can use the money any way we want.
And we're really the new kid on the block as far as fundraising is concerned. Most community colleges have really not done that, and I've done a lot to try to encourage that, because when I was president at Pasadena City College, we did have a very active foundation. It was helpful, but it wasn't anything like a substitute for public funding. Now, we can try to form relationships with business for our career technical programs, like hospitals will aid our nursing program, or the automobile manufacturers will furnish cars for use in our auto technician program and so forth. So we're going to do that as much as we can, and we're going to try to push that, even though the community colleges are, as I said, very inexperienced in this area. Some do a pretty good job at it. Others have done very little in it. But it'll never replace the public funding that's absolutely necessary for our operation.
I hope I'm not telling tales out of school to share that the Stanford Development Office has two attorneys working full-time to try to undo restrictions on funds, most of them from prior eras, for goals and programs that are no longer relevant. But they have two people working full-time trying to open up access to restricted funds. Someone wants to know, if you could be granted one wish, what would your wish be to better prepare California students for higher education?
Well, I'll tell you, maybe it's the law professor in me and teaching too many years. To me, I mean, you have to know something to be prepared to go into higher education. You have to be able to read a paragraph. But I would say, to me, critical thinking skills are the next level. To me, whether you're training an automobile mechanic or a neurosurgeon, give me the person who can think and solve problems and integrate ideas. And again, I'm not saying you operate in a vacuum. I sort of want the physician to know where the, if the kidney's in a different position than the lungs, it would be very helpful during the surgery. But I'm not saying that at all, but I have this fear of this commodification of knowledge. It is a fear of mine that it's just by rote feeding back to some instructor what he or she wants to hear. So I think the critical thinking skills, another way of saying it is, if all our young people, including our low-income students, could take Algebra 1 and Algebra 2 and really make progress. Charlie Reed really knows much more about it than I, but I think those things will stand you in good stead in college and for the rest of your life.
If I had one wish, I'd like to see the public schools get better in California. Now, that's self-serving to Mark and I, because we, and Jack, okay, we would all three be the beneficiaries. And if they get better, we will get better. But if you think about it this way, if the public schools could prepare students who graduate from the 12th grade who are ready to go to college or ready to go to work, and that's pretty much the same thing as Mark said, that they understand mathematics at the Algebra 2 level, that they understand how to communicate orally and in writing, and they know how to analyze things, because that's what they need at the community college, UC and CSU, and that's what they need to go to work. So that's where we've got to make some improvements.
And 70% of our students who graduate from high school come to us, and they do not test at the level of either one or both, in some cases, English and math. So, yes, we've got to improve our public schools, and that's terribly important. And certainly critical thinking is very important, because we're going to change jobs. If we're actually trained for only one job, we're going to be lost in this world in which these graduates go into. And we, you know, I was chair of the Senate Education Committee, so I dealt with both K through 12 and higher education. And one of the things that's been tragic in the last 20 to 40 years in California and in the nation in some ways, we have not fully appreciated the teaching profession, and we have not really, we don't pay them well. Now, I think they must perform, but we don't pay them well, and we don't really recognize the value of teachers and what a difference they make in the lives of students in the K through 12 school. And so I had my two sons. One of them got a teaching credential, and the other one got a law degree. Now, you can imagine which of the two was paid twice as much as the other. So all I'm saying is we've got to, some way or another, once again, appreciate and really value the teaching profession and the changes it's going to make in the lives of K through 12 students.
All right, let's talk about a few possible solutions, because the audience is coming in with a lot of very interesting ideas here. This one is headlined, "Bring in more international students. How can CSU boost international student enrollment, who can then pay full out-of-state tuition and offer great diversity?" And I think that it applies to all three systems.
You know, approximately 10% of our students come from out-of-state and from international. And we do make money off of those students because they pay full cost. Actually, they pay a little bit more than full cost. However, the taxpayers of California want their children, their students, to come to the California State University. And they paid these taxes for years, and they deserve. So we can't crowd out California residents for international students.
And of course, American higher education is the most valued higher education in the world. So if you look at the statistics, no other nation attracts the number or even the percentage of international students as American higher education does.
Yeah, I think we could do a little more at University of California. We're about 7%. We might go to 10. But the crowding problem is really an issue. We've tried to keep the state students, you know, keep lifting those numbers as best we can. But we're a public university. We're created by Californians, largely for Californians. There are some public universities that undergraduates are 30-40% non-residents. I just don't think it's viable in this state.
So there are structural issues with the state budget, and a number of people are thinking about this and working on it. Tom Campbell, when he was state finance director, and others have been pointing out for years that a one-year budgeting system in the state of California, plus the two-thirds majority needed to pass the budget, give us a gyrating cycle of budget ups and downs. What would you think of the proposal that's now floating around for at least a two-year budgeting process, a reserve fund, a rainy day fund, as our governor calls it? In other words, let's try to smooth out these great gyrations and begin to plan for, do some planning that would smooth out the ups and downs that are caused when the economy declines, the tax base goes down, and so on. So do you see any need for that type of structural reform at the state level?
Well, I do. I was in the legislature for 12 years, and I went through 12 different budget battles. And so I know a little bit about this. And I have to tell you, the two-thirds vote is, there are only three states in the United States that have a two-thirds vote. And that cripples us. A lot of people think, oh, well, it keeps those fools up there from spending all that money. But the reality is it empowers one-third in either house to hold up the budget as long as they want to. So that's a structural problem. I wouldn't mind working on a two-year budget. But right now, when we talk about a rainy day fund, and I think that was certainly in order during times when it was flush, it's a little difficult to create a rainy day fund when you have a $19 billion deficit. So I think that's a future possibility. If I had my wish after being in the legislature, I'd say one is you need to get rid of the two-thirds. Two is you didn't really improve the legislature by voting in term limits because particularly in the assembly, that means one-third every 2 years are rookies. And I was pleased to see that finally we did change the issue of redistricting so that legislators don't draw their own lines. I think that's a forward thing. But just as someone who spent 12 years in the Capitol, I can tell you we do have some structural problems. And I hope that the voters of California will eventually try to address those structural problems.
The other structural problem, there are many, and you know them better than I, but this tax system is not very good. And I used to teach some of this stuff, even the property taxes and all that. And the problem is the economy goes down 5% and the tax revenues go down 15%. And that's part of it. That's one of the reasons we're suffering. I mean, think of it this way. We have approximately, correct me if I'm wrong, Jack, a $1.8 trillion economy in California. We have an $18 billion deficit. So we have a deficit less than 1% of the state product. President Obama would be thrilled with that level of deficit if that was all he had to manage. He has to manage a great, but because of the structural problems we're talking about and a tax system where the revenues fall more rapidly than the economy, it looks like we're shooting for the moon to try to deal with essentially an $18 billion problem.
It depended on income tax and not on property tax. You see, our income tax is frankly high. It's and our property tax in relation to other states is low. So what is the most volatile tax you can work with? It's the income tax. That's a volatile tax. I mean, capital gains and all the rest. So you're going to have this roller coaster thing.
You know, it's not raining. It's storming, okay? But, you know, I would say what Jack and Mark said. You know, the two-thirds vote for the budget's ridiculous. You know, it ought to be a majority vote. Now, I would keep a two-thirds vote to raise any new taxes or revenue. And so there is a balance there. But the other thing that I want to say is California's tax and revenue structure was built in the horse and buggy days. We got, you know, a completely different economy today. California is a service economy. California is a worldwide economy. That's where the tax system ought to be aimed at rather than, you know, this antiquated revenue system that's in place.
So if you see these structural problems as far-sighted leaders, is this type of advocacy within your purview as opposed to this year's budget? That is trying to, if you truly believe that we should be spending budget funds on education and that we ought to be able to predict better what the revenues are going to be, base them less on the ups and downs of income taxes, are you able or willing and politically able to do advocacy on these larger issues?
Well, back in the end of October, 1st of November, your paper here, the San Francisco Chronicle, printed an op-ed piece that I wrote about how the prison system and higher education were completely out of whack. So I think we can advocate in that way. I do not believe that it is my responsibility to advocate for a single tax, that this is better than that. You know, there used to be an old saying, you know, if you give me the facts on them, I can put the tax on them. But that is not the responsibility that we have. Our responsibility is to let the policymakers know how many people want to go to college, how much it's going to cost, and what our budgets, and then be accountable and to report back to the public how we've used those resources.
What is the most helpful role that California's independent colleges can play over the next 5 to 10 years, especially with respect to the public system? That I read to mean private colleges.
Well, I would say a couple of things. It's interesting. One of the parts of the master plan that was never fully implemented was the degree of participation by the private colleges. And I'm not criticizing. That's just the way it's been over the last 50 years. So I think in meeting these needs that Charlie and Jack talked about and I've talked about, we have some fabulous private colleges, and you know I know they have problems too, but from our standpoint, enrolling more students and serving more Californians would be very helpful. And then we do have collaborative programs. We have a very close relationship with Caltech and except on the football field with USC. And So I would say is that I really do respect them and they're doing great work, but the numbers are so large in California, it is hard to believe. Look at the numbers in the community college. We're 220,000 and we're a fraction of the number of students here. I don't see them really solving our problem. I think they need to keep plugging away. And of course, great institutions like Stanford, they have medical breakthroughs and inventions and they help create industries and jobs. That's all good for California.
I agree with that, but what we've got to do is get the public and the public policymakers to understand what is best for California. Now, that's not what is best for UC or CSU or the community colleges or the privates. What is best for California? And then go from there is what I think.
What are your responses to recent protests by students across California colleges and universities?
Measured. I have to say a couple things about that. Really, when we raise our fees, it's always very reluctantly, and you're sort of backed into a corner. The people who vote for the budget know what you're going to have to do with the fees. The second thing to say, this is the most fulsome state I've ever been in for financial aid. We set aside a third of all the fee revenue for financial aid. We have the Pell Grants, we have the Cal Grants, and now we have an Obama tax credit, which goes up to $180,000. So the fact is, this year, we raised fees 15%, and three-quarters of all families with incomes under $180,000 did not see a one-penny increase in their fees. And the next thing I want to say is that's not the whole story, because we have institutions in some of the most expensive metropolitan areas in the country. The living expenses are high. So I'm not saying it's not a struggle for many families, but in terms of what we control, that is the pricing we control, we've tried to deal with that. In other words, you shouldn't ask what the sticker price is. You should ask what the average or net tuition is and who's being receiving assistance and who is not. And if you want to know the truth, the truth is that the group that is most at risk is the middle class, because there are more resources to pour into the bottom end of the income distribution, and the people who are making, whatever, $500,000 a year, they can write the check. The middle class is most at risk as you see this acceleration of fees, largely in response to declining state resources.
Well, you know, unfortunately, sometimes the public wants Swedish services on Mississippi taxes. It's not going to work that way, folks. It's we've got to eventually pay for it. And so what ends up is that when the legislature doesn't get enough money, particularly for CSU and UC to operate, they then are forced to raise fees because really the legislature expects them to. Now, sometimes people are a little hypocritical in sense of then raising, you know, fuss about it. But if you don't want the CSU and the UC, and of course the community colleges, we happen to have the lowest tuition of any community college in the nation. So we have a very reasonable kind. And really, when you compare CSU and UC to similar institutions throughout the nation, they're low. That's right. So it's, sometimes we focus on that, and we don't realize that, you know, that they've been forced into a corner to do that.
But we appreciate students and their ability to express themselves.
We are public institutions, and we expect to hear from the public. And so, you know, that just goes with the territory.
Well, we're wending towards the end of our discussion, and I'd like to close it off by asking each of you, what are your smartest, most strategic, outside-the-box strategies for dealing with the current situation? What smart ideas have each of you been able to move forward on in your own systems?
Well, I can give you a few. Some Charlie mentioned. We're far behind the private sector in our IT systems, our supply chain, how we do our travel. We think we can save $500 million in the next 5 years. That's one. I think we ought to look at, in particular areas, three-year degrees, not for everyone, but we could shorten the time to do it. More transfer students, and then I think virtual education online. These are probably the most promising avenues.
I would, of course, I'd already referred to the transfer and making the transfer much more seamless. We're also working on this whole idea of basic skills. We are aware that some way, somehow, when they come to us with lacking those skills, how can we be more successful in bringing those students up to college level? And we've found some innovative ways by which we can bring them in as a cohort and do it in an accelerated way, and we're going to try to reproduce that throughout the system. We have to look at ways in which we can improve instruction and improve student success. We are a great institution from the standpoint of access. We want to continue to work on success for those students because we're dealing with the most vulnerable students.
For the last year and a half, I have not been successful, but I have sure tried to sing this song to members of Congress, to Arne Duncan, the Secretary of Education, to the White House, and others. The Congress funds public schools today with something called Title I, which means that they give extra money to schools of poverty. But that stops at the 12th grade. And what they help those students, they tutor them, they get, you know, free meals, they have smaller classes, They really focus on those students of need. Well, they quit at the 12th grade. And so I have proposed to Congress and the White House and others that they need to continue that. Just because the 12th grade ends doesn't mean that those students don't need continuing assistance, tutoring, special classes, better academic advising. That costs more money. And so I'm not going to stop advocating for that, but I think they're going to have to figure out a way, because if you look at California and you look at America, that's the population that's in the public school system.
Two of the Commonwealth Club's original five founders in 1903 were President Benjamin Ida Wheeler of the University of California and President Frederick Burke of San Francisco State University, then San Francisco Normal School. That's just one of the reasons we regard the future of our public higher education system in the state as such an important issue. Our warm thanks to Mark Yudof, President of the University of California, Charles Reed, Chancellor of the California State University System, and Jack Scott, Chancellor of the California Community Colleges, for being with us this evening and engaging in such a lively and productive discussion. We also thank you, our audiences here and on the radio, television, and on the internet. I'm Gloria Duffy, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you're always in the know, is adjourned.